Thank you so much. Good morning, and dear colleagues and friends, ladies and gentlemen. It's a great honor to be here in Doha and in the Middle East. It's actually the first time for me in the Middle East. I hope it won't be the last. I work in this unit over here. It's a teaching and university hospital in Stockholm, affiliated with the Karolinska Institute, where I have my research. I will speak a little bit how I do ACL reconstruction in combination with an osteotomy. The short version of this talk would be: do the arthroscopy, prepare the notch, address other pathology, harvest the graft, do the osteotomy, do not increase the slope, use a suitable plate, possibly bone graft, drill tunnels, and fix the ACL. The problem is a little bit greater than that, so we have to take it more slowly. We have this symptomatic OA knee with instability, and how to deal with that? Well, there are different ways to proceed, but which is the best way to go down the line? Where are we? First, we have to look at the classification of the OA knee. I usually use the Ahlbeck classification, and the ones that I think are suitable in my hands for osteotomy are Ahlbeck 1 or 2, or perhaps 0, if you just have slight changes on the articular surface. The Ahlbeck 3, 4, 5, with more bone loss, I don't think are the best cases for osteotomy. This is an Ahlbeck 2, with total loss of joint space, but no bone loss. This is the knee story, the traveling from the beginning to the end. This young guy, he probably had an ACL in combination with his bucket handle medial meniscus tear, and that someone ripped away. The cartilage still looks nice, but down the road he goes, and he creates more and more osteoarthritic changes, and eventually he will end up like this, which is the knee, true knee story, and I'm sure all of you have seen that before. He might be ending up like this guy, who was 34 years old when he got his ACL and medial meniscus tear, and 24 years later, he has this severely osteoarthritic knee with translation, and this is certainly not suitable for an osteotomy in combination with an ACL reconstruction. What is my pre-op evaluation of the symptomatic unstable OA knee? Well, you have to take a good history. You have to assess the symptoms. What kind of symptoms do they have? Is it instability or is it pain, swelling? And try to track the different symptoms to try to choose the most suitable treatment. You also have to talk about the patient expectations and the treatment goals, because it's not certain that these guys can go out there and play football again on the same level as they used to do 10 years ago. You need weight-bearing X-rays, of course, AP and lateral, and you need long films, hip knee angle films, to find the mechanical axis. You need to assess the laxity of the knee, the laxity of the other knee, and then the instability of the specific knee. You need to assess all the other compartments. Are there changes in the lateral compartment, patellofemoral compartment, previous arthroscopic findings? Try to find the old charts from this previous surgical procedures. You might want to do another arthroscopy if you're uncertain how the knee looks, or you might want to do an MRI. But most of the times, you can get this information if you try to dig into the history. How much should we correct if we do an osteotomy? Well, if we do only an HTO without the ACL reconstruction, most authors think that you should do the osteotomy bigger if you have more cartilage changes. This is sort of irrational. If you have one-third of the cartilage height decreased, move the mechanical axis about 15%, two-thirds 25%, and three-thirds about 30%. This will give you a point close to the Fujisawa line over there. If you have an ACL deficient knee without concomitant ACL reconstruction, you should probably try to bring it over even more, and you should try to decrease the slope, as we heard in the previous talk. If you do simultaneous ACL reconstruction, you actually need less correction because it produces some external rotation. You have to sort of figure this out before and plan before you do your operation. Let's have a look at the mechanical axis. This is a closed wedge procedure, which I used to do previously, but I don't do anymore. This is the one-step staple. Don't use it. It's impossible to take out. Much easier to put in than to take out. But in this case, the mechanical axis is changed to approximately the Fujisawa line on the lateral eminence of the tibia. And then we have to take care of the posterior slope. If you use a closed wedge HTO, it's easier to decrease the slope. So it's easier actually for an ACL deficient knee if you use the closed wedge procedure to get a decrease in the slope. However, with proper planning, you can decrease the slope or increase it or whatever you want with the open wedge osteotomy as well, if you just do the proper thing when you operate. You have to sort of move the hinge on the lateral side, anterior or posterior, depending upon if you want to change the slope, decrease it or increase it. And this is the plate I'm using currently, and I have been using that for about 8-9 years. Is the Tomafix plate, which is gives you an excellent stability. It's quite big, but it gives you perfect stability. And that's the main thing with the osteotomy. You need perfect stability, and especially with the ACL reconstruction cases where you want them to get going quick. You don't want to put them in a cast or in a brace. You just want them to move about that knee. So what about open versus closed wedge? Well, open wedge, we know that we can restore leg length, we can get better angular precision, at least I think you can get better, more precise angular precision. You preserve the tib-fib joint. It's easier to increase the slope in PCL insufficiency. And I think it's easy to convert it to total knee replacement with better PCL integrity if you have used a open wedge procedure. And this is published in a paper by Tim Whitehead and Pete Fowler in the Journal of Arthroplasty a year ago. So the closed wedge, which is the traditional way to do it, gives you faster healing. It's easier to decrease the slope in ACL insufficient cases. But to tell you the truth, there are really no long-term differences between open and closed wedge. So at least no long-term series with the modern plates. So I think the surgeon should choose the osteotomy method that he's most familiar with. So my preferred method for the HTO is the open wedge Tomafix plate fixation. I use bone graft if the opening is more than 7 millimeters. The guys in Switzerland who does this a couple of hundred per year, per surgeon, they don't use bone graft. They can open up to 50 millimeters without bone grafting. Staubli, who is one of the inventors of this plate, he doesn't use bone graft. But in this case, which is not an ACL case, I actually open up 50 millimeters and fill it out with bone graft. So I think for faster healing, bone graft if more than 7 millimeters of opening. I use partial weight bearing 3 to 6 weeks and full range of motion immediately. So what are the treatment options for OA and ACL instability? Well, you could do nothing, physical therapy, brace the patient, wait for the TKA. Or you could do the HTO with slope correction for the varus knee, or the distal femoral osteotomy for the valgus knee. Or you can use the osteotomy in combination with the ACL reconstruction in one or two stages. What you shouldn't use is just to do the ACL reconstruction only. It's a bad option. It will fail and the patient will not be happy. He will still have pain and he will get his instability back within just a short period of time. You should not put the unicomp in the unstable knee either. So my indications for the combined ACL reconstruction and HTO is the various osteoarthritis with ACL instability, giving away symptoms, anterior rotatory sublux, varus thrust could be a case, and certainly younger patients, the older patient group, you might only want to do an osteotomy, and they need to have a desire for a higher activity level if you should do two operations at one time. You could also consider the ACL reconstruction in combination with an HTO if you have a varus knee, the morphotype varus, without OA, but with an ACL injury. Otherwise, your ACL injury or ACL reconstruction will probably fail. So in these cases where you see that the patient has a morphotype varus, you should do the long films to see the mechanical axis before you decide what kind of operations you want to do. So, should we do it in one stage or two stage procedure? Well, let's look in the literature. Medial OA and ACL instability. Pete Fowler, he advocates only HTO. The two-stage procedure is advocated by Rolly Jacob, Lederman, and McIntosh, and the one-stage procedure, HTO and ACL reconstructions, by several authors in the last years. Most of the French guys, for instance, use advocated in one stage. But at the end of the day, this is true orthopedics, a lot of opinions and little science. True evidence based on RCTs are lacking in this matter, as in most of our actual surgical procedures, I would say. We will have to change that. So my usual ACL approach, well, I have three different approaches. I for the primary ACLs, I do either a hybrid double bundle with one tunnel in femur and two tunnels in tibia, or I do a double bundle inlay, which I have sort of designed myself with two tunnels in femur and two tunnels in tibia, or an anatomic single bundle procedure. So Freddy Fu, for those of you who know Freddy, he always talks about the concept of double bundle, the concept of this and the concept of that. So I created a new concept, the concept of triple AP, as anatomical as possible. Because we can never be truly anatomical, so we have to just try to be as anatomical as possible. So this is just x-ray of a double bundle inlay technique, and this is my hybrid technique where I have two tunnels in the tibia and one in the femur. And this is with a bioresorbable screws on the tibia. And my preferred one-stage HTO and ACL reconstruction, I use either the anatomical single bundle ACL or the hybrid double bundle. I don't use the inlay because it takes a little longer time, and I think these two techniques are more suitable. I use the open wedge tomofix plate, and I'm more generous with bone graft in these cases because I want to get them going early. I normally don't use a tourniquet, but if I do, I always deflate before closure of the wound, so I can see that there is no bleeding from the vessels behind the tibia. So this is briefly my way of doing it. I start with an arthroscopy, clean up in the knee. I size the femur and identify the ridges. I normally use a ruler to measure the femur, and I identify the two ridges that we previously heard about. And I decide my entry position for the tunnel in the femur. I mark the tunnel, I do the endobutton drilling, and I measure the tunnel length. Then I go back to the tibia, and I do the incision for the osteotomy, and I harvest the graft. So should we take one or two tendons? Well, why take two when if one is enough? So I normally only take, in about 95% of my cases, only the semitendinosus, which give you quadrupled greater graft diameter and sufficient length, and I think better graft properties. And if we look in the literature, there have been several studies the last 10 years that certainly all come to the same conclusion that you bone tunnel enlargement. So I take this free flap, and the effect of periosteum is, as I said, that it has pluripotent stem cells in the cambrium layer with potential to induce bone and cartilage, and it's essential for direct insertion of a ligament. And then I prepare my graft to quadruple, hook on the endobutton, and I suture, this is a little blurry picture here, but I suture the periosteum around the graft approximately at the entrance site for the femoral tunnel. Okay, and then I do the osteotomy with an open wedge technique. I use two pins, one for the osteotomy and one for the slope direction, so I can adjust for the slope. So I see with this pin where the slope goes, and then I can look at that pin and see how I adjust my slope. I open the desired gap. I use fluoroscopy to check alignment with rods or the diathermic cable. Staubli in Switzerland uses a diathermic cable, which is sort of quite inaccurate. So it's almost better if you use long rods and use the fluoroscopy, and you can more exactly see where you will get the mechanical axis. In this particular case, the incision is the incision is much longer than I normally do, but I had some other problems here that I wanted to address. Normally I do two incisions or one smaller incision, and you can slide down the plate. So, like I said before, I'm generous with bone graft. And in these cases, if I do an opening more than 5 millimeters, I usually bone graft. I fix the plate, and then the osteotomy is really stable with these LCP screws. And then I go back into the knee. I complete my femoral tunnel drilling. Now I know what length I have of the femoral tunnel. I drill through the medial scope portal always to get the as anatomical as possible position. And this is a view from the medial portal. Then it's time for the tibial tunnels, and you use the same jig as normal reconstructions. You have to sort of, and this is also one advantage with drilling the femoral tunnel through the medial portal, because then you're not dependent upon the tibial tunnel. So you can put these tunnels wherever you want. Sometimes you have to take this screw out and replace it with a shorter one, but most of the times you can bypass these screws. And actually with this hybrid technique that I have, it's almost easier, because then the two tunnels for the tibia are smaller than the big one. So it's usually not a problem. So I drill the tibial tunnels or the tunnel if I do a single one, and this are the two. This is the PL and this is the AM, and you get a very good coverage of the footprint if you do like this, as in most double bundle cases. And then I introduce the graft. And if I use a single bundle, I do it through the tibial tunnel, of course, like we always do. If it's a hybrid, I introduce it through the medial scope portal. And then I flip the under button. And then you pull it down in a retrograde fashion. I start with the PL, go up with a grasper, and just take the sutures, pull down the PL graft, and up here you can see the graft coming out from the medial portal. That should be around here. Pull down the PL into the hole. The PL is in place, and the AM is still hanging up here. And then you grasp the sutures for the AM. AM going down. And you have both bundles in place. AM, PL. And view from the medial portal, it looks like this, and the coverage of the footprint is really fan-shaped, like we want it to be. And this is from the lateral portal view, PLAM, knee and extension. So I fix the ACL graft with under button seal on the femoral side, and on the tibial side you use interference screws, normally metal or bioresorbable, matrix or bio-RCI. I fix the PL in 20 degrees of flexion and the AM in 60 to 70 degrees of flexions. That's my normal way. This is a 38-year-old male who had two previous ACL reconstructions, and he was referred to me for revision ACL reconstruction the second time. And the reason the first revision had failed was probably that they didn't take the long films before they did that, because he was in varus. He was in 5 degrees of varus, and he had created an Ahlbeck 1 medial osteoarthritis, and probably the reason for the second failure was his varus knee. So we did the ACL re-revision with the CMIT from the contralateral leg. We opened the wedge about 8 millimeters. Try to make 1 or 2 degrees of slope correction to decrease the slope, put the tunnel fix plate on, and bone grafted. And then at the post-op, the knee was found to be stable, and the long film showed 3 degrees of valgus. So hopefully this will last longer than the two other ones that he had. So what about the rehab combined with in a combined ACL reconstruction and HTO? Stable osteotomy allows full activity, range of motion, and partial weight bearing. And I use sort of a semi-aggressive ACL rehab. I put them in full weight bearing after 3 to 6 weeks, normally 3 weeks, if the correction is not too big, and full range of motion immediately. So what about failures? Well, the normal failures after osteotomy is progressive OA, loss of correction, or increased instability in the case with an ACL insufficiency. And the causes are usually wrong primary indication. Maybe they had a fixed subluxation from the beginning, which I think are not suitable for this technique. Undercorrection is probably the most common cause of early failure of HTO, or slope ACL graft failure. This guy, he had a combined ACL reconstruction and open HTO 8 years previous to this picture. He lost his correction, his tibia subluxed anteriorly, and his ACL failed, and he was unstable. And to solve this problem, the only way is to give him a total knee. This 53-year-old gardener, he had two previous ACL reconstructions, the first with a synthetic ligament, and the second one with CMIT. The last one was done in 97. Good range of motion, but he had gross giving way problems, medial OA, and instability, pain, and swelling. He said, "Doc, I want one more operation in my life. I don't want two. I don't want three. If I want the second one, it has to be when I'm 80." So, and in this case, with this anterior sublux tibia, I don't think the osteotomy would be a good option. So he got an uncemented total knee, and the bone graft, his tunnel defects. So in summary, combined HTO and ligament procedures are rare, but a good option in selected cases, especially ACL reconstruction with a stable osteotomy. And I use the Tomofix. There are other plates out there that work probably as well as that one do, but this one is really stable. And it allows early rehab. However, a well-planned HTO might sometimes be enough by just changing the slope. So make sure you use the correct devices to reach the goal. And thank you very much.